What happens when three buffoons give life advice, explore unrealistic situations, and give random topics more thought than they probably deserve? It's the Spitballers Podcast with Andy, Mike, and Jason.
The mouth trumpet?
That was a real trumpet.
Oh, you brought yours. Yeah, there it is. Wow.
Let me put this away.
It's a shiny
Kerplunk.
Trumpet.
Kerplunk.
Kerplunk.
That's not the noise a trumpet makes.
You're one of those comedians that goes up on stage with his bag of props.
Oh, I would be a Carrot Top for sure.
Most people don't
forget to close the door. Honk, honk, honk.
Most people don't say that with pride. Like, I would be a Carrot Top. But you said it with a sense of, you know.
I would wish you luck at your shows, Mike, and I would not show up to that.
That's fine, because
I'm
pretty sure that Carrot Top, well, maybe at one point of his life was financially stable. I don't know. I don't know if he's got a good wealth manager.
He certainly has a good steroid salesman.
Look,
you seen that dude?
You can
allegedly does a lot of juice.
If it quacks like a duck.
That dude is buff.
He is ripped. He got made fun of a long time being called Carrot Top. And then he's like, you want to make fun of me?
Yeah, he is literally like the scrawny comedian who found his way into a science laboratory and said, Doc, they keep making fun of me.
Yes.
Gets a syringe that's like 12 feet long. Let's see him make fun of me now. And then there's lightning strikes the lab.
Call me a vegetable.
His clothes rip off.
So I have not actually looked up Carrot Top in a long time.
You weren't aware?
I knew he was jacked, like crazy muscular. But I did not realize that his face was the actual model for the new Momo thing going around. He is a scary faced monster.
He's terrifying.
That is a terrifying face.
No, like we had the Momo discussion last night. And look, I'm fairly confident that this is just a Andy just pulled it up.
It's
a complete hoax. And look, I get it. These things float around that. And it's terrifying.
It's the scariest looking face.
The idea of what was being presented. We're not going to get into all of that stuff on this show. But it's, as a parent, it's terrifying. And then you're like, okay, I got to look it up. And then you Google that word.
Yeah.
And you are like, there's not a lot that freaks me out.
Yeah.
Bro, that face, I have tears in my eyes.
It is.
I'm not. Oh my gosh. Don't freak. What is happening? Why are we talking about this?
Jason's fault.
It's Carrot Top's fault. Don't do that to your face, bro.
Welcome to the Spitballers
Podcast.
Give me
the Momo.
I already knew. Give me the Momo. Would you rather?
Would you rather have Carrot Top's face or Momo's face?
I'm just, like, the last thing I'll say is I imagine Carrot Top at the end of this thing. It's full Joker. He's in the chair. Give me the mirror. Give me the mirror.
I already knew this was going to be a weird show because Jason, we got here. Jason's not even feeling well. He didn't need to come in to work today, but he did anyway. And
then
he's trying to put his headphones in, and it's like a cartoon where a guy's jumping rope and ends up like wrapped up in the rope. I mean, he couldn't get him around his head. He couldn't get him out.
I'm under the weather. I would not have come in if not for this show. I literally just drove in. I'm leaving right after this show. I'm on all sorts of DayQuil, NyQuil combinations right now. You know, trying to wake up from the NyQuil.
Ow,
with
get
the
sensor
DayQuil
button ready.
And I'm loopy, and I'm terrified.
So we have a... And this show's going to be great, by the way.
For all the things we've said about Carrot Top, it looks like he's doing just fine at the Luxor, so he's still performing.
Okay. All right. Look,
last laugh is for him.
Not only is Would You Rather in life advice on the show today, but we have a... what I think is going to be one of our greatest drafts ever.
Yes.
And I'm just going to tell you what it is right now.
That's stay tuned for this.
Disney Battle Royale.
Yeah.
So we're drafting Disney characters to join our army and battle one another. We did this with, didn't we do two?
Food? We did it with animals.
A food fight, right?
Yes.
And we did it with animals. Now, I want to do an ocean battle royale at some point.
Definitely need a sea battle royale.
There is a theme with our show. Apparently, we really like imaginary fights.
Yes. Yes, that's true.
Oh, a celebrity battle royale!
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's got to come someday, fellas.
That will happen. But that's the draft coming up. And I want to let the spitwads out there know, those that are loyal listeners to this show, we've heard you. We've seen your reviews. We appreciate all the love on social media. Al Borland is just glowing on a daily basis, our producer.
We're going forward with Al Borland.
Well, yeah. It's not our fault. It's his fault. He's wearing another plaid shirt today.
I tried to help you. But you did nothing to help yourself.
Al. Yes. Yeah, Al is behind. He's manning the levers and pulleys.
He's got all of his tools back there.
Yeah. So, listen, lots of good.
Take care of my trumpet.
I'm trying to tease out something here. A lot of great stuff is coming for Spitballers fans.
Yes.
We're going to bring this show to video. So that'll be one thing that's taking place. We are, the wheels are in motion. Al has got his tools out. He's working on the set. That was one of them. Mike, once again, pulls from his trick bag. The other thing is we're going to be doing stuff. We're going to be, I don't know how much to say.
Say it all.
But we're going to be creating a little community for the Spitballers. Let's put it that way.
Fantastic.
Okay. And we've got good things planned. So I think we're 37 episodes in on this show. And
35 more than I thought we'd make it.
You thought we'd get to two?
Yeah, two and call it quits.
So we have a great show today. Find us on Twitter at SpitballersPod, on Instagram, Instagram.com/SpitballersPod, Facebook, iTunes, everywhere. We don't have a review today, so let's go ahead and get into the first segment.
Would you rather?
All right, this one comes in from Jeremy on the website. He says, would you rather be sick half as often, but the sickness would be twice as intense, or be sick twice as often, but the sickness be half as intense? This is timely because last week Mike missed a Fantasy Footballers podcast due to...
I was man down.
You were two man down. Your wife were both down.
It was the unique... And, and everyone's experienced it, but it is the absolute worst when both parents are sick. Usually the virus has at least the decency.
Yeah, the respect, the kindness.
To slowly infect your family, let you have at least one parent.
Double dipping.
I mean, this was 911 to the grandparents. We both, in the morning, like, on.
Boop,
yeah,
boop,
just,
boop.
Dad, help. Send help.
So your kids didn't get sick?
No.
And you and your wife, now who's the whinier sick person?
I'm sure it's me.
Okay. I was just trying to put you in a position in trouble since you guys got me in trouble on the show last week with my wife looks weird in a mirror.
No, I know. Why did you bring it back up?
Well, I mean, it's just so true, right?
Yeah.
How did I do that again? Yeah, great.
And then I'm sick right now. My sickness is not nearly as bad as yours.
I couldn't function.
You sound nasally, very nasally.
You never sounded better, Jay.
It's amazing. I mean, amazing. I don't understand how one nostril can be running while the other nostril is completely clogged. And then 10 minutes later, they flip-flop. Sometimes I can breathe. Sometimes I can't. I have no idea what's happening in my head.
Well, you did mention you're on a cocktail of drugs.
That might help.
Look. I have an answer to this question. I would rather be sick half as often and twice as intense. And here's why. I don't want to be known as sickly.
Yeah.
If you're sick all the time, even if it's little things, number one, nobody's going to listen to your complaints, and I like to whine and mope. If you're really sick, people, oh my gosh, you were that sick? Oh, let me make you some soup. And you want some from the store? They're just so compassionate, and I soak that up. Feed me.
Trust me.
On pity.
Not only do I know what you're talking about, I know because I lived that life. in high school, I was the kid with the horrific allergies, horrific asthma, and...
Nasal spray.
That was
your nickname.
Yes, exactly. And I didn't like school, so there was no pushing through if something was wrong, which led to... Yeah, got the black lung.
I got the black lung, Pa.
And this led to a nickname that that can't be mentioned on this.
Oh, no.
On this program.
Ask
that was
Mike about nicknames.
Really? Yeah, you got a nickname from your friends.
Oh, yes.
I see.
Look, it was a term of endearment.
Hmm.
But it
yeah.
Can't
I've
be
got,
said here.
I've so got you, some ideas.
So you both are going the Band-Aid route.
Look, there was a strong alliteration. I'll tell you that much.
You guys are both going the Band-Aid route.
Yeah,
rip it off, get it out of the way.
I get sick maybe at the absolute most once a year. I would say I'm man down once every 2 years. So to me, that's like incredible, incredible sickness, but every 3 to 4 years.
See,
I'll take that.
I would take the other approach because now I get
you're
your
living
argument.
That life right
I
now.
I am living that life. I get your argument of the boy who cried wolf. Maybe you don't get as much sympathy.
I'm
going to
call you the
always,
name.
If you're just always sick. But I really enjoy a light sickness. I mean.
Because he's willing to make it sound like it's the worst sickness in the world.
Andy. Did we have the gym this morning?
Yes.
Did I go?
No.
You're darn right I didn't. You're darn right. Mike.
Oh, sick.
We're working today. What yep. am I doing when this show's over?
I imagine you're going home and
you're
going to
darn
bed.
Darn right I'm going home and I'm going to sleep. And if I can do this twice as often but never really
oh
be
gosh.
All the way down and out. You think I
see.
You think I'm too sick to play some video games at home? I don't.
That was, dude, the absolute best and worst.
Oh, you want to be in that middle zone of sickness,
well, no,
right?
I want to pose this question to you guys. I want to find out what the rule was in your household. And this is not referring to high school. I'm talking like elementary school. So when you're sick and you're home from school, it's because you're actually sick. What were the rules
upon you?
What was the television rule and what was the video game rule if you were home sick from school?
Yeah, I think this might play a part in my current status as a man. I was allowed to do whatever. I got the pity. I got the love. It was, you're sick. You just play your video games.
Uh-huh.
Thanks, Ma.
See, back then, I got the black and white TV moved into the bedroom.
Yes.
What? Into the room?
They'd move it into the room, and I could sit there and watch my Price is Right, I Love
Lucy.
Wait.
Time out. Legitimately, you had a black and white television?
Yes.
Did you have a... I don't think I ever had...
Those aren't
we
real.
Were not
those
born
not
in the 50s. We were born well past black and white televisions.
I mean, this was the early phase of life, yeah.
Oh, mercy.
I'm younger than both of you, by the way.
I'm searching invention of color TV.
Yeah, I think the Wizard of Oz started the color fad.
Look,
well before
guys,
we were
it
born.
Was not until the mid-1960s.
Oh, that's...
We're talking about.
I was sick. I gotta get the
we're
black
talking about
and white.
A portable TV.
It's your birthday. We're bringing the
how
black
many,
and white in.
How many TVs did you grow up with in your house?
Merry Christmas. Here's a black and white.
When you were 8 years old, how many TVs was in your house? Were in your house? Because we
two.
Had one.
We had two.
We had one TV in the main room, and it had all the push buttons. So it was like a Sony, and it was probably like 20 inches. And then we had one black and white that was like in my parents' room, and
okay.
they'd watch TV with
okay.
us.
I remember my cousin. They
yeah.
his parents had a black and white in their
we
room.
We went through a rich phase. This
very
was
nice.
A very short lived rich phase. I always talk about it.
Jason
my wife knows
D.
about the
Rockefeller.
Rich phase.
Did you have Carrot Top managing your wealth?
It was so. I don't know. I was around the age between like 8 to 12. That was like this really short, because we were never well off. We weren't destitute, but we were, you know, whatever. And we had this small period where we came into some money, and that was, it happened quick. It was over quick. But I remember we went from one TV in the house, and then Christmas morning came, and everyone had a big old color JVC in the
everyone?
Old bedroom.
In your
oh,
room?
In the bedroom. We all had it. Big old, I think this thing was like 29 inches color TV right in the bedroom. We did the thing where we rented the big screen television. That was a thing you could do
yes.
because you just didn't buy them for the NBA playoffs because the Suns were doing well.
Well, not everybody. I was watching Andy Griffith on black and white televisions.
Well, then it was true to its nature. I mean, yeah. watching Andy Griffith on a
that's
TV that
true.
Has color is just that's, a waste.
That is a waste. We were efficient with our non-cable television.
He didn't know the difference because he was only allowed to watch black and white shows.
Yeah, wasn't
so
everything
was...
in black and white back then? Weren't the NBA players all in black and white?
Andy Griffith was in started in 1985, right?
Yes.
All right, here's another question for you. Would you rather discover that you are an android while everyone else around you is human, or find out that everyone around you is an android and you are human?
Oh, sweet mercy.
That's a great question.
It has to be that I'm the android. It has to be. I cannot live a life where I look and I'm the last human left and everyone around me is a monster machine. Because if I found out that you two were androids, right, I would view you as villains. You would be evil monster machines out to...
Programmed to pretend to be friends with you.
Exactly right.
But either way, you are discovering something that you have to keep a secret. You cannot let this get out.
In either situation?
Yeah. You're going to have some sympathizers to your android life, but there's going to be people who don't want robots walking around.
Yeah. So look what happened to the X-Men.
It's a Clark Kent / Alf situation.
Clark Kent / Alf?
Wait, hold on.
You know, a classic Clark Kent / Alf sitch, as I always call it. Where it's like...
If I didn't know that you're watching so much Alf right now, it really...
Explain
yourself.
You can tell the people right around you. Your closest friends can be aware of your alter ego.
No.
Well,
Clark... Look, no one knew that Clark Kent was Superman.
Okay, Peter Parker. Peter Parker told his closest friends.
I don't think so.
Well, he did in the movies. I know so.
Didn't he pick a patch of pickled peppers?
And then Alf, the family knows, but, the doorbell rings. You got to hide behind the couch.
So here's the problem. If you find out you're the only human, you still have your humanity, but your whole world changes. If you find out you're the android, there'd be this, like...
You're fake, man. You've been...
Introspective program. Like, nothing is real about you. I think I'd rather nothing be real about anybody else. I think I could handle that psychologically better.
To my point, now you are the human, and defending yourself against androids is going to be impossible.
Well, that's the thing.
If you're the one android and people start finding out, I think you can handle it.
Nothing is more amazing than the human body and mind. I mean, humans are just unbelievable. But if there was an android that could truly, truly... be convincing as a human and you don't know the difference in their emotional range and all that, I would see them as superior.
They would be.
And like, if we were going to do a push-up contest, I assume I'm losing.
You assume? Wait, so there's a tiny part of you that's like, I'm going to out-push-up this robot?
It's 10%. But I think I got a chance.
Why do we assume that
the human spirit
androids are more superior? Because we've already lived our lives not knowing that they're androids?
Because we know how much our bodies are going to break down over the next 60 years.
What are you talking about? We know this because robots do industrial jobs, and they never stop.
Yes, they do. I'm not taking it to the push-up point. I'm taking it to the why are they better than a human? Because one virus, the whole world except for you, could go down.
All right, let me ask you a question.
One EMP.
Andy, let me ask you a question. What is 789 times 3,456?
It's got to be about 20.
Well, this machine in front of me knows the answer.
So if you can do complex multiplication, you're better?
Better at math.
Well, find the multipliers in this world. Give them the leadership positions.
But how disappointed would you be in yourself if you found out you were an android, but you struggled with math? Because right now, I might be an android. I don't know it. And then I find out I'm an android, and I go, but wait, why can't I do 1,000 push-ups? I threw up at my evaluation with my trainer.
You're too human-like.
You've got really a bad operating system.
Yeah. Oh,
look,
man.
Donut OS.
You're right. That would be the toughest thing of all time.
I'm the best worst machine ever.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so...
I'm taking the machine.
I'd rather be a human and find out everybody else is an android.
I will be the machine.
All right, let's get into some life advice.
Spitballers to the rescue.
All right, this question or this life advice question comes in from the web. Today, I went to the bathroom at work. Congratulations.
Classic.
Yeah, man, I've done that. Been there before.
We can relate. While sitting on the toilet, scrolling through Twitter, I heard a female voice. I am a dude. At first, I thought she was in the wrong bathroom, but I have since realized I am in the wrong bathroom. Oh. I am scared now, and I don't know how to leave.
Oh, goodness.
Help me. Oh. Help me.
That's an incredible situation.
Oh, goodness.
I mean, you have to wait a long time.
Like, first off, for this guy, how do you walk into a bathroom and be like...
I can see it happening.
No. No, I totally get the door. I'm talking about when you actually get inside and go, this toilet is sparkling clean.
Oh.
This floor is manageable. Like... It should be firing off red flags immediately that there's not just urine everywhere.
I'd like to believe that in some buildings,
yeah,
both restrooms are clean.
I would probably walk in there and go, oh, they just got done with this.
They just got done cleaning.
I just caught it at a good moment. Let me pee on the floor and get this back to normal.
I will say this.
Helicopters, man.
The amount. Helicopters spin pee?
Look, the bathrooms that you've been into.
Do you put your arms out while you spin?
I am not a monster. I'm talking about when I go into a public bathroom at like Disneyland and you go, what are these people doing?
Nuclear bomb goes off. Look, we had this.
You're talking about the pier.
Yes, I'm talking about the pier. We had.
You see, like, there's one in ten.
We'll get back to the actual life advice here. But first, I want to share at our old job. It was a corporate office, and it was a very small, you know, normal-sized restroom. There was one stall and two urinals, and only a handful of companies used this bathroom on this floor.
Yeah, there's probably five companies.
Probably five companies, probably a total of maybe 50 people.
Yeah.
And
25 men, let's assume.
Yeah, and every day we'd go in there, and somebody would have stood in front of this urinal and just missed.
No, I think they...
I mean, just a pool.
I think they stood like 6 yards back.
Right.
And
tried to make it.
You
and
would...
Hit and failed.
Going the distance.
You would have to walk up to this urinal if you're going to use this after said mystery person had used it.
Yeah.
And you'd have to try to do Jean-Claude Van Damme splits around the pool so that you could...
And so this guy went into the lore of the building. He was the peer.
Did you talk about it with other people in the,
the
building?
Oh, we would
not in the building.
It,
but like, in the
office. Did you try and solve this? We tried to solve this.
Yeah.
Very much. This became work.
We accused each other of being the peer. If somebody went in there and thought they had been clean earlier, but then somebody else came in, that wasn't there before.
I have an announcement. The super long con.
On this show, you break out that I've been peeing on the floor.
I knew someday we'd have a podcast.
And I would have a platform to tell everybody. I peed on the floor.
I'm the pisser.
So,
for years.
The question.
Yeah, what do you do now? Well, clearly, here's what I want to know.
Oh, my goodness.
Before you answer that, Jay.
Okay.
There's two phases. Phase one is, because I assume the answer is going to be, I'm going to wait until it clears out and sneak out.
Yes.
But what do you do when, like, do you pick your legs up off the ground because you're afraid of revealing that you're a man?
I wondered the same thing. No, your legs have to be down, but I am covering, I'm strategically placing the pants on the shoes to where you can't tell.
Like, you don't want to see the ankle hair?
Right.
So she's looking over?
Well, no, because if you're at work, I'm assuming this is like work where you're wearing some type of fancy shoe. And you're going to know it's a men's dress shoe.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. You got to cover it.
With your men's slides.
What are you wearing, Doug? But what are those, JNCOs? I mean, how are you covering your shoes up with your pants?
You can't pull your legs up because then someone's going to try to come in.
Yeah.
They might see you through that slot. It's a bad situation.
Oh, do you think they'll try to come in? Oh, and then you have to say,
someone's in here. Sight's tight.
Yeah, we've had that discussion.
I will say this in all honesty, there have been countless times, maybe 500 times, where I have meandered mindlessly into a restroom.
500 times?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty often occurrence, to be honest.
That's a lot of meandering.
I'll be
call him the pisser for nothing.
I'll be in a restaurant or something, and I'll just meander in, and I just assume, you know, and after I get in, I have the terrifying shock, the moment of like,
did I go in the wrong one?
Oh, no, I didn't pay a lot of attention, and the sight of
hand
a urinal.
Hand on door?
No, door closed.
You've stepped in.
So now, you know, I'm in, and the sight of a urinal is the best sight I ever get, because I go, it's the men's.
Oh, thank goodness. Yeah.
I'm batting 1,000.
Do you have to, you know, what if somebody does knock? I mean, do you have to try to alter your voice?
Oh, no. What do you do?
Almost done.
You got to cough.
Thank you. Oh, you have helped this person.
You can't do the fake lady voice.
I'll be out soon.
I mean, that's not going to...
Just powdering.
Yeah, a cough or a sneeze.
Just powdering.
Just powdering.
In the stall.
My nose.
I go into the stall to powder my nose. I have a little beer on my compact.
What is...
But they don't let me do it at the desk, so I come into the stall.
What is this depiction of women? This happening?
It's Miss Doubtfire, because it's man playing the woman.
Say, there's been enough movies where the women run off to powder their nose. That's just what I assume is happening. There's powder everywhere.
Been a run by fruiting.
All right, so
yeah, I mean,
you got to wait this one out, right?
You got to wait this one out, but you also have to do the sprint.
You could.
Yeah, you got to be.
Once it's time, once it's been a full 60 seconds and you're sure that you're in the clear and the room is empty.
Now, if you do happen to be leaving and then a woman's walking in,
you're dead.
Do you just claim that you were refilling the paper towels?
That's not a bad idea.
Yeah, you just all clean.
All clean. All clear in here. Everything's good.
So it's not,
took care of it.
So it's not the sprint. It's the walk out with confidence.
Yeah,
it's
you
the
do
walk
need to
out
go,
like, I was supposed to be here. Oh, nothing to worry about.
Or what if you just refer to a cleanup that they don't know? I took care of the... I cleaned it all up. Yeah, it's all good now.
Or you try to trick them. You say,
I think the pisser was here.
Oh, no, you say, oh, that's the wrong door.
And then yes!
And then they look. And
then by then you're gone.
And by then you have smoke bomb and you're gone.
Okay, so smoke bomb is the kind of last resort here. All right, here's one more life advice question before our Disney Battle Royale draft. I posted a bike online recently for $50. Someone immediately reached out, paid me, and said that they would be there to pick it up in an hour. Between the transaction and then picking it up, I received tons of messages saying I had a $300 bike.
Mm.
Am I contractually committed to the first deal? Can I back out even though I've been paid? So these people reached out to you out of the goodness of their heart to tell you you're listing this bike for way not enough money. Because you listed it at 50, then they go, no, that's an expensive bike. Don't sell it for 50, but you committed to it.
Well, not only have you verbally agreed, you've taken payment.
You did take payment.
You've received the moolah. I mean,
I have to imagine this is a digital transaction.
Yeah.
So this isn't like cash in hand. Man, I would be really hard pressed not to send that money back. That's a large discrepancy.
Are they on the way? Oh, they will be there to pick it up in an hour. You're done.
Yeah, it's over. You gotta honor your deal.
Yeah.
It's $250. This isn't like, oh, you could have gotten $75.
It's a $200
and you go shoot.
It's a $250 lesson.
That's right. It is. Because if you hadn't taken payment, I understand sending them a text and saying, I've got other interest, I'm sorry. It's Craigslist. People stiff you, they don't show up. It's weird.
But man, it's because the thing is, so you posted the bike. I'm trying to walk through it. You post the bike. You say $50. And the first person that posts and they say, I will take. I mean, generally speaking,
you should be happy.
Yeah. You're happy. And the person who says, I'm next in line doesn't say, I'm next. I'll give you $300.
That's why I think a couple, you know, you might have posted it on Facebook. Someone accepts it. They pay. Then you've got like a handful of your biking friends and they send you a little message. And they just say, dude, that bike's worth a lot more than $50.
Yeah, you got to do a little research on your bike.
Yes. I think you made a mistake.
I mean, it's like an item as big as a bike, or I should say, as valuable as a bike. This isn't a dresser you're about to get rid of that the value is completely up in the air of whoever wants to buy it. This is a bike. There is a set amount of money that this thing is worth on the market.
Or
isn't
like
it?
A, so
I'm
like
with
a,
you guys.
Like
that's
a toilet seat that might be worth $750.
Uh-oh.
And it just goes accidentally goes to Goodwill for free.
Here's the funny thing about all of this. And he was referring to me.
Yes.
Because I may or may not have had a very pricey object.
Whoops.
And we gave it away. But here's the thing that's funny, because you, one of you guys alluded to it. I don't know who. If you didn't know it was worth $300, you're happy you got a sale and a purchase that fast.
Yes.
So it's all perspective and greed.
Yes. It's. Yep. I was going to bring up the greedy aspect of this.
It's all the missing out of what I could have made. It's not this, because the same thing happened. You wanted $50, you got $50. If nobody tells you it's worth more than that, you're happy.
It's FOMOM instead of FOMO. You're fearing of missing out. It's fearing of missing out of money.
Yeah, FOMOM, as they say.
That's
what the kids say these days.
I mean, because nobody wants to. I mean, when they show up to pick up the bike and they go, yeah, I'm going to need another 50. I'm going to need another 250.
I'm holding your bike hostage.
Yeah.
No, you got to be happy. You got to take it.
That's when you give them a little miniature bike and just claim that's the one you would list it.
Oh,
you got to go find a replacement bike to give them quickly for $50.
We were selling a media cabinet. And so when I say the words media cabinet, what do you immediately think is going inside of this?
Black and white TV.
I think DVDs.
DVDs. Yeah. So we listed a media cabinet with the dimensions on top of it. And we had it out. Someone taking it. So we leave it out on the porch. They walk up. They're like, oh, I thought I was going to be able to put like clothes in it.
What?
Like we listed,
did they pass
this
on it?
This isn't a closet,
and they passed on it. They thought they were gonna get a dresser sized cabinet for $15 that was called a media cabinet, and the dimensions were listed.
Oh, okay.
I hope you're listening.
Was there
to this.
No photo?
There was totally a photo.
Oh my goodness. Wow.
Everything was there.
It is a crapshoot, like, when you do those arrangements.
What people think they can get off of swap meets on Facebook is absolutely ridiculous.
So do you, maybe that's what you do. Maybe this person needs to take the chain off their bike and let all the air out of the tires.
Oh, get them to pass on it when they show up.
Yeah.
And get them to say, hey, I want a refund.
Yeah. All right.
You figured it out.
That's your only option.
Yeah.
Oh, where's the tire? I'm sorry. I thought you knew it didn't have a tire. Do you want your money back?
Take the seat out.
Yeah.
Take one of the handlebars.
Oh, my gosh. We just gave real advice on how to ruin somebody. There's going to be another letter in from the other guy. I just bought a bike for $50. When I showed up, it had no seat, no tires. What do I do?
And we would tell that person, you're out of luck. There's nothing you can do.
You already bought it.
Oh, my goodness.
Do you live in your mistake?
It is a day. The people you meet on there, I tend to think I'm a very friendly person, and on a one-to-one conversation, I feel like I'm a generous person. I'd like to say that I give people a good deal on there, but when you are listing an item on Craigslist or SwipSwap or whatever, you got to be cutthroat. You have to be able to tell a person, if you're not here in 10 minutes, I'm not selling. I'm going to sell to somebody else.
It's a tough life.
They'll stiff you. They won't show up if you hold
it. I have sold at least 50 products on, I think, predominantly SwipSwap, and I think I've had two successful transactions.
Wow.
I mean, I've never got it to work. People, I'll be there at 2. I'm running late. And they don't. It's like there
and
are
you,
people
you
who are hired by competitors to just go on and bid and win stuff and never show up. Like, their full-time work is just to
ruin everybody on it.
Oh, we also had the recent one where the lady shows up and does the old, pulls the money out of the wallet. She's like, oh.
Yep, I was going to ask you about that.
I've only got 15, and it's supposed to be 20. It's like, would you take 15?
What'd you say? Yes, you said yes.
No, luckily the wife was handling it, and she said, oh, no, I've got someone else who wants it. And then the lady
mysteriously found another $5?
The lady's like, well, hold on, let me go see
if it's in my car.
If I have something in the car.
Oh,
she goes to the car, pretends to fiddle about in there for like 3 minutes, comes back with this story of like she has this spare money she usually keeps in there, but her kids had found it and cleaned it out. But luckily, she found $5.
Oh my gosh!
I mean,
you sneaky.
It's 25 now, lady.
You darn right.
You
it
got
is.
Plenty in that car. Bring it out.
That's what we should have done.
I love that your wife didn't give in to that.
Yes.
That is some bull.
I could never have stood my ground there.
That is
ever.
You if have to have like, people waiting. That's the key.
If I have 15, if I was the wife in that situation, I'm at the door, I'm sorry, I only have 15, I'd have been like,
all right.
Yeah, okay. Don't tell my wife I took 15.
Don't tell my wife.
You take 5 of your own dollars.
Yes.
Put it in with it and go,
I got 20 for it, babe.
You start supplementing.
Yeah.
I love
it. I'm losing out big time.
Oh, my gosh. Let's get into the draft.
The Spitballers Draft.
That's too funny. Too funny. All right. We are doing a Disney characters mock draft. Now, it is important to note, this is not all. It's not Disney and all the subsidiaries. There's no Star Wars in here. We actually aren't even letting Pixar enter in.
Which is dumb. I stand to the side and protest.
You do. But there are enough Disney characters out there in the world, in the ecosystem. We're only drafting 4 per team. Snake draft. Mike has the first pick.
And I'm very happy about it.
Let's just remind people what's going on. Maybe they haven't heard the term Battle Royale before. But you picture Rome, ancient Rome. We're in the Colosseum. And all 3 of us walk out, and we've got 4 friends with us from Disney movies. And then someone says, fight! That's what we're doing.
We're battling
our teams against one another.
Now, are you sure after I give my pick that you guys still want to follow
through?
I think you should
get that pick, and then Andy and I draft 4 each,
and then
you get waiver wire fodder.
All right. So, Mike, you have the first pick.
It's the genie.
Yeah, of course it's the genie. Right.
Phenomenal cosmic powers, bro.
Itty bitty living space.
Yeah. So he's not living in there when we're fighting.
So he's free right now, though, right? Isn't he free?
Yes, he is.
So he may show up, he may not. That's what I'm saying.
I'm pretty sure all of these characters are free to not show up. Yeah, free to not.
All right, so the genie is gone. I've never heard of that character, but whatever. No, the genie, solid pick, the obvious number one. I was hoping that somehow it just wasn't.
Well, here, the good news for you is there is an obvious number two, Andy, and I don't. So if Jason with his medicine head somehow misses it,
I think I have my obvious number 2, but
I will be so disappointed if Jason doesn't.
Okay, this show's over. I feel sick, and I think we should record this in another week. And because it'll be a new week, I get the first pick. I am really upset here, and here's a little mistake you're about to make. Peel back the curtain here. I was prepared for the number 2 pick. I was prepared, but I got hoodwinked right here at this desk before the show because no picture. It's Mr. Incredible's my pick.
There's a better pick than Mr. Incredible.
Now, here's the thing. There are 2 better picks than Mr. Incredible. I agree with that. I don't know what Andy's about to take. He's got 2 coming up, and I'm trying to play the game of what could come back to me. I think both could come back. I don't want to play one side of it, so I'm just going to take the guy that I love. Look, it seems like every draft possible that I can draft The Rock, I'm doing it.
Okay.
So you have a genie. I'm taking a demigod. I'm taking Maui.
Okay. That's a great pick.
He's got magic. He's got power. He's a fighter.
That's a great pick. It's not the clear number 2 pick, but it's a very good one.
It's not the clear number 2 pick. I agree with
you. How do you spell that?
Maui? What?
Is it just M-A-U-I?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I got it in there.
You know, what
so
can
you
I
took
say?
Maui? No, I
except
think it's
you're welcome.
I think it's a very
that's a good pick. That wasn't even on my list.
No, it wasn't on mine either. And that's a great pick to counter a genie.
Yeah.
I think that's solid. I'm taking brute force. I've got 2 picks back to back. I am taking the Beast.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
From Beauty and the Beast.
Okay.
Okay.
You got some raw power there.
And I'm teaming him up with another raw.
You're going
power.
All physical.
I'm going
all physical
very
strength.
Physical.
All right.
And I'm going Simba.
Yeah, okay, Simba.
I'm taking Simba. If you give me a chance in a battle royale to draft a roaring lion, I'm going to take it.
I assumed someone would draft Mufasa because
that would be a good counterpick to Simba.
Yeah, well, I think Scar would be a better counterpick to Mufasa.
Scar can't fight.
I'm pretty sure Scar already beat Mufasa. Sorry, spoiler alert.
He tricked him.
Cheater.
We're in a gladiator dome. You think he's going to get a good stampede through? Does he have stampede powers?
I am happy.
I can't believe that the pick is still on the board.
I am happy that it came back to me. You got the genie.
This is upsetting.
You've got, you know, power galore. I've got to take Jafar, who is himself a genie, at the end of that movie. He is a genie. Cosmic power.
Okay.
I'm taking...
You got Jafar. And so, Mike, do you get the pick you want?
I do. You guys are crazy.
So what's the obvious pick to you?
The leader of the Greek gods?
I thought about that one, yeah.
No. You cannot...
That's a Disney cartoon.
That's a
Disney movie.
It was a Disney movie. But that's not a Disney character.
Oh, yeah,
yes, it is.
They did not come up with this character.
Disney hasn't come up with a single character in their life. They go take stories that they can get for free.
This is a normal character from a movie. You're taking Hercules.
No, I'm taking Zeus.
You're taking Zeus, the dad?
I'm taking...
Now I understand Jace's problem.
Well, I mean, I just feel like...
Wait. There's not a problem if it's Hercules.
Because that's the name of the movie, the character that was made.
But the point is...
Hercules is a Greek legend.
Yes, he's a Greek legend. He's not a Disney character.
Neither is Snow White. Neither is Pinocchio. Neither is Peter Pan.
I won't be drafting Pinocchio or Snow White in my battle royale.
Like, have you guys never noticed that Disney... Like,
no, I know that.
They don't make up characters.
Oh, they make up plenty of characters. They just made up all of the characters here.
I don't think they made up the genie.
Actually, Lion King is also a stolen story.
Okay. I don't like it, and I protest, but whatever.
Okay. Well, I'm going to take Zeus.
Okay, so you've got Zeus.
Yes.
The Greek god. You just drafted a Greek god.
You are correct.
Okay. All right. Changing my options here.
That's why I was surprised that you went with no magic.
Yeah.
Man. So then I'm flabbergasted over here because I never thought that this was going to happen. So I was ready for these other picks.
Well, then you should be really ready because you got one that dropped to you.
All right. And
yeah. Right?
That should work in your favor.
Well,
no,
because I'm playing the game of Jason. Like, now what can actually come back to me with the pick? Because I never thought that a Greek god would make it back to me. I am going to... Oh, goodness.
So weird, because I would never think of Zeus as a Disney character.
Never. And I love that he took him, because it's going to ruin his draft. People are going to go...
I think you're right. All right, who's your second pick,
Mike? It actually hurts your genie pick. I think we can win here, Andy.
I think so. All right, go ahead.
Okay. I am going to take... Well, then... God, now you got me tilting.
Yes.
You're darn right we did.
Tilt your face off. I don't know what that means.
Goodness. All right, I'm going to stay with magic then, and I'll take a quote-unquote Disney character.
Like Zeus.
Like the Disney character Battle Royale draft we're doing. All right, who do you have?
I can't draft Mr. Incredible as a Disney character, but he can get Zeus.
Yeah.
One of those is a Disney character, one is not.
One of those is a Pixar character, I'm sorry.
Disney owns Pixar, and also...
ESPN.
Yes, I draft LeBron James.
You wouldn't have to take... Like,
make a pick, Mike!
I like how you just said LeBron James is an ESPN character. He's a character for the movie ESPN.
He's been on the television show.
Yes. Mike, channel. If you don't make a pick,
right,
you're losing
it. I'm going to take another magic person.
I heard Eeyore.
Shoot.
Yep, I heard it too.
I'm going to take another magic person, a sorceress, very powerful sorceress. I'm going to take Maleficent.
Interesting.
You're just picking stuff I can't spell properly.
Yeah, it's
that is my number one goal.
All right, so
we're also in big trouble.
Coming back to me here, there are a couple characters I like. I'm questioning Hercules because Hercules should be drafted.
Yes,
he's allowed to be drafted. I mean, I've already got
I'm really glad I threw it out there. That's awesome.
Oh, he would have been. That's who I thought Mike was drafting because, I don't know, he seems like a Disney character.
Yeah, he is a Disney character.
Zeus does not seem like a Disney character.
And that's what's going to hurt Mike.
It is going to hurt Mike.
I love it. Hercules seems like a Disney character.
Well, because
the name of the movie is Hercules.
Yeah, I don't know if you know that, but they made this movie called Hercules.
Yeah.
There's a song called Hercules.
No, is there? There's a song called Go the Distance, which I referenced earlier in the
episode.
Isn't
that Michael Bolton?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, give me Michael Bolton. I'm taking Hercules.
That's a good song. You can get Michael Bolton. He's a Disney character.
Oh, I'm taking Michael Bolton. No, I,
wait,
I want.
All right.
No, give me Hercules. I've got two demigods here.
Look, I have to battle back all this magic power. This stinks. I've got the Beast and Simba.
Oh, by the way, Maui, not a Disney character. Not a Disney creation.
Okay, stop. Stop it. We're not debating Disney creation.
I got to just make my point.
It's not a good point.
Nobody vote for Mike. A vote for Mike is a vote for evil.
I think what we're saying, genuinely, is that Zeus seems such a peripheral character in that movie that we don't prototypically think of it. Like, Maui is obviously one of the main characters of the movie.
Mm-hmm. Well, you guys got to go deeper.
You
can take the Frog Prince if you
want. I can go the distance, Mike. I'm taking King Triton.
Okay. Okay.
Also, basically Poseidon. Okay,
yeah, that's fine.
I missed who Jason took.
He took Hercules.
Okay,
yeah.
And that was an official.
Enjoy being out of the water in the Colosseum.
Shut up! It's a battle royale.
Out of the water?
I took Ariel's father.
And he's dead.
Who's basically Poseidon.
He can't breathe.
Just flopping
around. He doesn't have gills.
He's flopping around.
He can breathe.
I take the Little Mermaid.
That's fine. He can breathe.
Yeah, he can breathe totally, but he's flopping around on the dirt. Oh, yes. King Triton. That's great.
Freaking disaster. I've got no hope. Because I'm picturing him flopping around.
Oh, yeah. Oh, just.
This freaking amazing.
I can't aim my
land?
Trident. Why is this on land? Because you put it in a Colosseum. You did this.
Oh, I made a mistake.
Oh, man.
Okay. I don't have any hope in this draft. I need another magical character is how I feel at this
There's
point.
There's plenty.
There are a lot of characters I still like.
One and you'll go, that's not a Disney character.
That's the one Mike will take. Mike's going to get zero votes because it'll be like, these aren't actually, Mike will get enough votes with the genie.
Yeah, the genie wins.
I've never.
Al Borland, who do you think that Mike is going
to. Yeah, let's have him weigh in for a second.
Do well with the Zeus pick and he's going to win the vote?
I do, yes. Oh. Zeus was a character in a Disney movie.
Well, get at it. Go build something. Borland.
Could I theoretically take Captain Jack Sparrow? Does he count?
Yeah, of course you can. Those are Disney.
Yeah.
I'll just chime in real quick. When you Google Zeus Disney, it says Zeus is a major character in Disney's 1997 animated film Hercules. He is the king of the Olympian gods and the father of the
I know who Zeus is, Al Borland.
I'm just saying,
why
Zeus
did
is
we
a major character
his
in
mind.
Disney's.
Major character.
Says the internet.
All right, I'm taking Elsa.
That's a great pick.
I was gonna take
magic. I need magic powers.
I was going to take Elsa if she came back to me.
Wait a minute.
You already picked.
Wait a minute. I know. I'm taking Elsa.
You're trying to fix Triton.
I'm taking Elsa, and I think I can fix Triton.
She can't make water.
Oh, she can. It'll take a little while to melt, but then he'll be comfortable.
So really, really thin ice.
He will be totally fine. I can make this work because this is a hot place. She drops a little ice, melts into a pool.
Water evaporates.
In 40 to 45 minutes, King Triton has got you.
All right. I've got a couple picks.
Get the worst draft ever.
I've got a couple picks that I like. You know, one of the ones that I consider, and I'll throw this out there because I don't think you'll take him anyways. I'm not going to take him, but it's kind of what I do. Peter Pan can fly.
I thought about Peter Pan.
You know, he's got experience fighting. But I also feel like he's kind of a little boy.
Can I trade out King? I have such a pick I want that I just forgot. Oh. All right, go on. I'll bring it up afterwards and I'll cry.
So I could go with another lion from The Lion King. A lot of my list, man, Mr. Incredible, Elsa, Sully. I wanted Sully to counteract the Beast, but you guys took all my Pixar away from me. Like,
yeah, we heard you complain already. Continue.
So I think I am going to – I still want some strength, This might not have magic, but Tarzan is a fighter.
Sure.
And he is he's able to counteract. I mean, he's going to beat up a beast, no problem. The beast was just a prince who got big and hairy. Tarzan
the
grew
beast
up
was,
in the jungle
in his,
with
in the beast's defense, he was a beast.
Well, yes. And, I mean, Gaston did give him a pretty good fight.
Yeah.
And died. So, well, I'll take Tarzan.
Gaston died?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Overtly?
Well, yeah, he falls into a large crevasse.
Oh, okay. I don't remember that.
That's how...
Spoiler alert. All right. You've got Maui, Jafar, Hercules, and Tarzan. I have the Beast, Simba, King Triton, and Elsa. Mike, you have the Genie, Zeus, Maleficent, and...
There are... there's the one pick I'm going to take, but there's two that I really want to take, but it's... Like their power is incredible, but neither of you are going to have any idea who they are.
Agreed.
And I'm concerned that
I would go with that. Part in a Disney movie?
No, he's a feature part, but he's not the main part of the movie.
This is dumb because there's so many characters I'm now remembering that I didn't put in.
There's
how
one
is
because
that my fault?
Like because you guys have made this into like these aren't Disney characters.
Now do you think if that's true? Then how in the world do you want to include a whole other category of Pixar? We can do a separate Pixar draft.
Those are Disney owns them, and they're animated cartoon characters and movies.
This makes you dig deeper. Mike, who's your final pick?
I mean, I'll write down who my final pick would be if I was stupid like you guys.
Okay, I'm going to take Merlin.
Yep, Merlin is what I'm writing down. Because...
No, Merlin is 100%.
Merlin is a main character.
Mike just won the
draft.
Yeah,
Merlin,
of course Mike won the draft.
Merlin is 100% a Disney character.
I just feel like when you're talking about classic, like Robin
Merlin's
Hood.
Merlin's a classic.
Robin Hood is a great example. Like, Robin Hood has been a character in a Disney movie, yes.
Sure.
But Robin Hood is not a Disney character.
That's what they all are.
They all are that.
They aren't all that.
Merlin is the wizard in the story of King Arthur.
Now, let's be clear. You're not picking Robin Hood from all the other Robin Hood movies. You'd be picking Robin Hood from
the
Disney Robin Hood
movie. But my point is, if you poll people and, you know, just like public opinion, you know, and you say, tell me about
like
Merlin.
Like
if
the
you say,
internet. Like the internet is public opinion
no,
when you put a type
if you
in
say,
Zeus.
If you say, no, if you type in Disney Zeus. If you type in Zeus. Yes,
oh,
that's
Disney.
What he typed
oh,
in. If
okay.
you type in Zeus, you're not coming up with Disney.
Okay. What word do you want me to search?
Merlin.
Robin, Merlin?
Yeah.
Okay. Merlin. A lot of nothing to do with Disney.
Yeah.
That's yeah. Okay. But
but that's my point. Is it? I don't feel like those are.
Well, if you put
Disney
Maui in,
characters.
You're going to get a island.
Ooh, that's a good question. Look, has Disney SEO'd
to me,
the island?
We're having a fruitless
oh,
debate because
the
draft is over.
The point was of secondary character that I wanted to take was, have you guys seen Fantasia?
Yes. I figured you might go that route.
You could literally take the devil.
Yeah,
oh,
Lucifer.
My goodness.
Yeah, the guy, the mountain guy. I don't know his name, but he is literally the devil. But I'll take Merlin. It's fine.
Merlin is the pick that I got really upset about that I should have taken instead of King Triton.
Yes.
But the
floppy dad.
I shouldn't have set up the Colosseum. That's my problem. I should have just left it alone.
Look,
because King Triton is basically drafting Poseidon.
Yes.
And I can't pronounce his name. Poseidon?
Poseidon.
Poseidon?
Nope.
It's P-O-I.
Yeah, but it's Poseidon.
Yeah.
Borland, how do you say that?
I just say Poseidon.
Yep.
Cheater.
This is what I will grant you this. You can have an outer ring.
Of water?
Of water.
Oh, so I get like a moat?
Yeah.
All right.
On the outside.
That is unnecessarily kind. But then your team is like, I don't care. Yes, like, so. Do whatever you want. I've got the genie.
What did you guys
I've
learn today? I learned that Jason has a real problem with this draft. That's
I have... legitimately a gigantic problem with this draft. This draft is null and void and does not count to me. I learned, however, that Carrot Top's face freaks me out.
Oh, that's what we both had a Carrot Top lesson. I learned Carrot Top's, he's still performing. He's at the Luxor. You can see him right now.
846 years old. It's Carrot Top.
Hey, make sure you subscribe to the podcast. It's free. Click that little subscribe button. You'll get every single new episode. We'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Thanks for listening to the Spitballers podcast. To see what other nonsense the guys are up to, check out spitballerspod.com.